So, hi everybody, I'm Josef, and together with Roland, I want to talk a bit about Zulang and our experience of using the other end of LLVM in GraalVM. Okay. Sorry about that. Yeah, we're doing research, and this is a research project, so don't buy any products because of the information we will talk about. Okay, so what is Zulang? Basically, Zulang is a LLVM bitcode execution engine. So think of it like what LLI does in a LLVM distribution. And it's executing bitcodes via interpretation of the bitcode, but also via JIT compilation of important parts of this of the bitcode. So what are we trying to achieve? Why we are building yet another LLVM bitcode interpreter? So our goal is to execute low-level or unsafe languages like C++ or others on GraalVM. So the big picture of GraalVM is it is a polyglot virtual machine where we try to execute all kind of different languages on a single runtime. So this includes languages like Java or Kotlin, Scala, which are JVM-based, but also dynamic languages such as JavaScript or Python. And we are adding Zulang in order to execute LLVM-based languages on this virtual machine. And one of the interesting features of GraalVM is that it can be targeted to a lot of different deployment targets. So for example, you can run it on a JDK, but also embed it in Node.js in a database, or run it as a standalone language runtime. So the GraalVM stack, the core technology in this stack is the Graal compiler, which was originally or is a compiler from Java bytecode to machine code. But we added on top of that the Truffle language implementation framework, which allows you to implement your language as easy as possible and get good performance very high performance because it uses Graal to compile to machine code. And Zulang adds all the kind of low-level languages to this stack of languages. The pipeline looks like the following. So we have ahead of time, we do the translation from the input language like C++ to LLVM bitcode using a frontend like Clang, for example. And then at runtime, Zulang is in translating this LLVM IR, this LLVM bitcode, into something that is a Truffle abstract syntax tree, which is then interpreted, but might also be compiled if the code is considered important. Zulang is an open source project. It started as a student project within Oracle Labs university collaboration. It is now maintained by Oracle Labs, but there's still a lot of student contributors. And one of them is actually here, and we'll give another talk about Zulang debugging. So this is really interesting stuff and awesome stuff. So don't miss this talk. Okay. So what's the advantage of having all those languages on one implementation framework? The advantage is that you can talk, all languages can talk with each other. And a lot of applications use actually more than one language. And the nice feature about Truffle is that it defines a shared interoperability interface. So you need to implement this interface only once, and you can talk to all other languages, although you don't know the languages, don't know the semantics of this language. So it is kind of this universal translator from Star Trek. You can like talk to everybody, although you have never met them. Yeah, but that's enough talking for now. We'll get our hands a bit dirty and show a few examples what we can do with this.
Okay. So I have prepared a little C program. So this program is just one function. I define a struct for a complex number, and I defined a function to print this complex number. So I can just compile this to LLVM bitcode. Zulang works on top of LLVM bitcode. So let's just compile this with debug info. And with the emit LLVM flag, so I actually get bitcode out of it. And now I've also prepared some little JavaScript code. And here I have, I don't know how many are familiar with JavaScript code, but you can just start writing code there. And we have this built-in that loads this bytecode file. And now I can just call this print function with an inline JavaScript object. And now I run it. And it actually prints a complex number, even though here I'm passing a JavaScript object to a C function. So how does this work? What is happening here? Let's look at the bytecode. The thing is, on the if you look at the C code, this actually looks like, yeah, right. I mean, why shouldn't this work? But looking at the bytecode, we actually don't see all that much here. We just see the get element pointer that we got explained in the last session. But we just see indices here, indices and offsets, and a load. And that's actually a nice example. What if the programmer wrote the same code using pointer arithmetics? So what we are actually doing here is we're looking at the debug info of this print complex function. And here we get in the debug info, we see the argument has this type, and we see here that the offset 64 bits, for example, is the member I. So if we see a read from a pointer from this JavaScript object plus 64 bits, then we know we actually need to read the I member from the JavaScript object, because in JavaScript objects are basically hash maps. So what else can we do with that? I mean, of course we can also write. Let's just change the value and of course compile again. And now, of course, to actually see something, we have to change the JavaScript code slightly. And so we keep the complex number in a variable, log it from JavaScript, then print it from C code, which will modify it, and then log it again. So just run the code again, and it works. So, what else can we do? This actually also works for more interesting data types than just integers, for example, function pointers. So in JavaScript, you can actually do that. You can just declare, yeah, this object has a member, which is a function, a JavaScript function. And on the C side, we just add the function, which in C, you write this function pointer and call it. So compile again and run it. Hello, LLVM. It actually works. So this also works in the other direction. So let's start over. And now let's add code that will allocate a native complex number. So in C, this is just, yeah, we just malloc an object, initialize it, return it. So that's actually now a native pointer. And on the JavaScript side, let's also add some function, in that case, a function to add two complex numbers. And now we're calling the native function to allocate the complex number, allocating a native memory blob. And then we add this native complex number and the JavaScript complex number. So we are actually adding two different objects, but they look like the same. And we print it. So let's compile and run. And we get the expected result. So, okay, that's a toy example with just the complex numbers, but I have something else prepared. So, for example, here I have a new C file that declares a struct big integer, which has two members, a function pow and a function toString. And the struct big integer class, which has a struct, like a value of function declared. So, and this is, of course, just the big integer class of Java that has, for example, a pow function. So what you can do with that is actually now we're adding code. We use this built-in to get the Java type Java math big integer. And in that case, we have to insert via a built-in typecast to actually tell our system, I know this is a Java object, or actually I don't know, I don't care what it is, just pretend it's this struct that I wrote here. And now I can just call member functions. And also like toString, that's now a Java string. And of course we also have API to convert the Java string to a standard zero terminated ASCII string and print the result. So we compile this. So here we just have an additional flag for it to find the header file declaring our APIs. And now run it. So this is the LLI from GraalVM, not the LLI from LLVM. And now we actually called Java code from C code, but we did not use this crazy JNI weird code. It actually looks like sane code. So why are we doing all that? Switch back to my presentation. So how does that work? The way this works is every language is building an abstract syntax tree, but in this case, we're mixing two languages. So what you're seeing here is, you see the AST, blue is JavaScript AST. So we have, for this statement, this is the add function, and you see here, we have a write statement which writes to the result object to the member I. And the expression is a plus, it's a JavaScript plus, which is very different from a C plus. And here you see the read, which is reading from a JavaScript object because the write argument was a JavaScript object, and it's reading the member I from the object B. But on the left-hand side of the plus, we actually inlined here the, I've written it here on the slide as C code, but it's actually the bit code, which is reading from the member I of the object A, which is actually a read with offset 8 bytes. And when this gets compiled, we just compile all of that together to a single machine code function. And that's where we get the advantage in interoperability, because the compiler can optimize through these layers. So why are we doing all of this? What we basically have here is a way to pretend that arbitrary objects look like arbitrary C structs, or native structs, or native data types. So we are doing this because we're building foreign function interfaces. All of these languages on this slide have foreign function interfaces that are implemented using C, C++, sometimes Fortran. So, and all of these, most of these function interfaces are really poorly defined. So, for example, that's actually part of the public header file of Python. So, which says a dictionary object looks exactly like that. And it does look like that in the CPython implementation. But it looks completely different in every other Python implementation. And with our technique with Zulong, we can pretend that our implementation object, which looks completely different, looks like this. So with Zulong, we get access to the language objects instead of the C structs. So going back to the slide, what is the goal of Zulong? Yeah, we want to execute low-level languages in GraalVM, but why do we want to do that? We want this because we are supporting native language extensions of Python, Ruby, Node.js, R, and so on. So now I told you what cool stuff we can do, and I'm just a project lead. I show cool stuff, and I give to my colleague who shows you what we actually still need to do to make all of this work.
So for the last part, I want to focus on the first kind of stage in this pipeline. So how do we get from C++ to LLVM IR? It boils down to the question, how do we, in general, compile native projects to Bytecode? And that's kind of where we had issues, and maybe some of you can help us. Maybe we're doing something just completely wrong. So for single file programs, this is actually not an issue, right? We just use Clang, we use emit LLVM, and we get for our C program our Bytecode program. But the thing the picture changes if we have programs with multiple files. If we try to compile this at once, Clang will tell us, yeah, emit LLVM is not really supported when linking. So, well, still not a big issue. We can do separate compilation, so invoke it twice, and then use LLVM link to get our final Bytecode executable. Okay, but we're dealing with all kind of different build systems, and we usually don't have them under our control, right? So for make, something like this might work. I might need to set some environment variables, but linking is already kind of probably won't work, and it depends on the make file itself. And it gets getting even worse for language extensions, because for example, Python, they have their own way of specifying how to build a native project. And yeah, you can even customize it. And a package called NumPy, which is a numeric computation library, which is very famous, it's actually customizing it in a way that they are parsing object files. So they're looking at the outcome of the compilation step to find out how a long double is laid out in memory. So this is a problem, and we need to deal with that. So Clang, unfortunately, supports fmbed Bytecode. So we can get an object file, but also Bytecode in one step. But again, we cannot do this at once, so we need to do separate compilation. And then if you try to like link this and get then some final executable and try to execute this, yeah, we'll find out that this actually does not work. And why does this not work? Because the Bytecode sections of those two files are only concatenated, but not LVM linked, because the linker does not support in that scenario linking of Bytecode sections in object files. Yeah, but there is a way to there is a way to invoke the linker to deal with Bytecode files, namely link time optimization, right? So we do link time optimization and then try again to get something out that contains Bytecode, but yeah, we will fail. The linker section will just disappear. We are not the only one having this problem. So there are cool projects like whole program LLVM and GLVM, and we use those wrappers in some of our projects. But they're all kind of working around the issue, right? So they try to be smart about the flags, how we invoke the compiler, and try to figure out if the compiler should be linking, if it should be compiling. Also, they usually need some kind of extract command to get the Bytecode out of the final result of the compilation step. And also, they support not all corner cases. For example, cross-compilation is not supported, at least not in all of them. It's interesting that the Darwin linker does support embedding Bytecodes in the final executable via these bundle files. So it's just a missing feature on Linux, it appears. And also, people tend to write custom wrapper code. And also, we do. And for example, in our Python implementation, you see something like graal python cc. And this is the kind of code where I don't want to see this code. We don't should need to do this kind of stuff. So what we are proposing is we should teach LLVM or the tools of LLVM to deal with that kind of stuff. So basically teach LLD to embed Bytecode during link time optimization, because all the bits are already there. We just need to connect a few dots and we should be done with it. And that's how it can look like. So we just do normal link time optimization and then link with some kind of flag to tell LLD to embed the bytecode, and we are fine. And we actually have implemented this. It's a small batch, which we are currently evaluating internally. And we're also planning to upstream this if there's any interest in the community to get this kind of stuff. Okay, so and I've only talked about Clang or C languages, but of course the whole problem is also there for Fortran. So a lot of Fortran code is used in native extensions, and we need to support this. So the same problem applies to Fortran, and we hope that this can be solved. DragonEgg is out of date, and we're really looking forward to F18. There were great discussions today, so we're really looking forward to that. So to conclude, we really love LLVM. It's allowing us to do a lot of awesome things. Some of them we've shown you today, a lot of more stuff. It's all open source, so you can try it out, get your copy of GraalVM, and yeah, try Sulon. Thank you.
So are there any questions? Okay, I will come to you.
I have two questions, actually. One is conceptual, another about implementation. The conceptual question is about semantics of the combined language. For example, in JavaScript, you could, let's say, delete a member, and then you want to access to this member from C++. Is it undefined behavior, or how it's supposed to work? And do you plan to specify such stuff?
So it's actually the polyglot interface, as we call it, specifies that stuff, and it's definitely not undefined behavior. So what will happen is you get an exception. Of course, you cannot catch it on the C side. You also cannot catch it on the C++ side, but that's a bug. But the idea is that you get an exception, yes. So if you try to do something that the other language does not support. And on the other hand, you can do everything, so there are built-ins for all the polyglot primitives. So there is a polyglot remove member, so you can actually delete the member from a JavaScript object from C code.
I mean, kind of a follow-up on this. So we are trying to do the things that a programmer might expect to happen. So what do you expect if you pass a JavaScript object to C++ code? I mean, it's already something that's not very common, at least not until, hopefully, soon. But it's kind of, we are trying to be like sensible, so and do the thing that is expected.
Okay, and the second question, you have to be conservative with respect to object representation. Let's say if JavaScript uses hash maps, you have to use hash maps for C structures and stuff like this. Is it true or
no? No, the C allocation is really what you saw. It's just a malloc. It's a blob of memory. So the thing is, you can pass this pointer to the JavaScript code. And for the JavaScript code, it's an opaque object. It doesn't know what it is. It just knows it's a foreign object. So it has to access it via the polyglot framework. And how this works is it's asking the LLVM part, how do you actually access that? So it's asking, like, please give me the abstract syntax tree for reading the member X. And Sulon will return an abstract syntax tree that will compile down to an actual, like, offset 0, offset 8 memory access.
Oh, okay, thank you.
More question? Well, then, let's thank the speakers again.